Welcome to nonstopneuron.com, where learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. In this video, we will talk about urea handling by Nephrons and urea recycling. Let's get started. Normal urea concentration in plasma is about 5 milliosmoles per liter. But at the tip of the pyramid, it gets concentrated up to 600 milliosmoles per liter. But how does it get concentrated there? And what is its importance? That's what we will see in this video. In this diagram, the upper part is the cortex. In the middle, we have the outer medulla. And the bottommost part is the inner medulla. We will assume that in the beginning, the concentration of urea everywhere is the same as in plasma. Now come to the nephron. These are various urea transporters located in different parts of the nephron. Please note that from the thick ascending limb to the outer medullary collecting duct, there are no urea transporters. So this part is impermeable to urea. Coming to urea handling by nephron. Like many solutes, urea is also filtered freely at the glomerulus. Now usually, we start the discussion of tubular processing from the proximal tubule. But the conceptual understanding of urea recycling starts from the distal tubule. So this time, we will start our discussion from here. Don't worry, we will go to the proximal part later on. Now, as I told you before, this part is impermeable to urea. So there is no urea reabsorption from this portion. However, the later part of this urea impermeable area is permeable to water. So water does get reabsorbed from this portion. Antidiuretic hormone, also known as vasopressin, increases the water permeability of this area. So in the presence of ADH, water reabsorption is very extensive. Now, reabsorption of water alone, without reabsorption of urea, increases the urea concentration in the tubule. By the time the filtrate reaches the inner medullary collecting duct, the concentration gets higher than that in the interstitium. So, the urea diffuses down the concentration gradient from the tubule into the interstitium. This way, its concentration in the interstitium also increases. Some urea is excreted in urine too. Now let's go back to the proximal tubule, as promised. Here, urea reabsorption is associated with reabsorption of water. So there is no significant increase in urea concentration here. So when this filtrate reaches the thin descending limb, the concentration in the lumen is actually lower than that in the interstitium. So in this portion, urea diffuses from the interstitium into the tubule. Now this fluid, with increased urea, enters the impermeable part again. In the collecting duct, the same process that we saw earlier is repeated. That is, water reabsorption alone, without reabsorption of urea, concentrates the urea even further. So again, more urea is reabsorbed at the inner medullary collecting duct. Then again, the same cycle is repeated. With each cycle, more and more urea is trapped in the interstitium. So its concentration keeps increasing. The final concentration depends on the level of antidiuretic hormone. Yes, this guy is controlling this entire drama. When water levels in the body are low, the pituitary gland secretes the antidiuretic hormone. The ADH, in turn, increases the water permeability of the entire collecting duct. So water reabsorption increases all across this area. So urea gets more concentrated in the collecting duct. On top of that, the ADH also increases the urea permeability in the inner medullary collecting duct. This increases the urea reabsorption even further. The maximum urea concentration that can be achieved this way is 600 milliosmoles per liter. Please note that the urea concentration in urine is also about the same during this. Thus, in the presence of ADH, urea concentration in the inner medulla, as well as in urine, increases up to 600. Now, if the body has excess water, ADH level falls. In that case, the water permeability of the collecting duct decreases. So water reabsorption decreases. So in the tubule, the urea does not get concentrated as much. Also, in the absence of ADH, the inner medullary collecting duct becomes less permeable to urea. Both these effects decrease urea reabsorption. So there is no further increase in interstitial urea concentration. Talking about the urea accumulated in the interstitium, some of it is excreted, and some is washed out by vasa recta. So eventually the medullary urea concentration also falls. Thus in water diuresis, the urea does not contribute much to the medullary hyperosmolarity. In such cases, most contribution to the medullary hyperosmolarity comes from sodium and chloride only. So this was the discussion of how urea gets concentrated in the medulla. But we haven't answered an important question yet. What is the importance of doing all this? There are two answers. One, this allows kidneys to excrete urea at very high concentrations. C, the urea is a major metabolic waste product of the body. So a huge load of urea needs to be excreted in urine every day. Excreting it at high concentration allows kidneys to excrete the daily urea load in a relatively small volume of urine. If kidneys try to excrete this much urea at a low concentration, they would need to produce so much urine just to get rid of urea alone. But thanks to this mechanism, it can be excreted at very high concentrations. So this is one significance of high urea concentration in the inner medulla. The second importance is that it increases the sodium reabsorption from the thin ascending limb. What? Sodium reabsorption? Yes, you heard it right. See, the descending limb of the loop of Henle is impermeable to sodium. So the sodium is not absorbed from here. However, it's permeable to water. And high concentration of urea in the interstitium causes water reabsorption by osmosis. So water reabsorption alone, without sodium reabsorption, increases the sodium concentration in the lumen. So when the fluid reaches the ascending limb, its concentration gets so high that it diffuses out of the lumen into the interstitium. Thus high concentration of urea in the interstitium indirectly increases the sodium reabsorption in the thin ascending limb. If you notice, this mechanism of sodium reabsorption is similar to reabsorption of urea in the inner medullary collecting duct. There also, water reabsorption alone, without reabsorption of urea, increases urea concentration. And here, water reabsorption, without reabsorption of sodium, increases the concentration of sodium. The role of urea, in this case, is that it causes water reabsorption due to its high concentration in the interstitium. Thus, a high concentration of urea in the inner medulla helps the sodium reabsorption at the ascending limb. Now, a few more points. Urea contributes to hyperosmolarity, mainly at the inner medulla. In the outer medulla, the hyperosmolarity mainly comes from sodium and chloride ions. This is because the thick ascending limb that reabsorbs sodium and chloride is located in the outer medulla. And the inner medullary collecting duct that reabsorbs urea is, of course, located in the inner medulla. Thus, the urea does not contribute to hyperosmolarity in the entire medulla. Moreover, it does not even contribute all the time. That is, the urea gets concentrated only when the body water is low, and the kidneys are producing very concentrated urine. In conditions of water abundance, the kidneys produce dilute urine. In that case, the urea does not get concentrated in the inner medulla. So this is all about urea handling by nephrons and urea recycling. Now let's have a quick summary. From the thick ascending limb to the outer medullary collecting duct, the tubule is impermeable to urea. Now, when your body water decreases, your pituitary gland secretes antidiuretic hormone. It increases the water reabsorption from the collecting duct. As urea is not reabsorbed from here, the water reabsorption alone increases the urea concentration in the lumen. So it starts getting reabsorbed at the inner medullary collecting duct. This initiates a cycle that accumulates more and more urea in the interstitium. This allows you to excrete urea at higher concentrations. So the requirement for urine volume decreases. The osmolarity in the inner medulla can reach up to 1200 during this. However, urea contributes to osmolarity only at the inner medulla. It does not have a significant contribution in the outer medulla, even during this. Now, when you drink enough water, the ADH level falls. Without water reabsorption, the urea does not get concentrated. So urea in the tubule is excreted in urine right away. Previously accumulated urea in the interstitium is washed out by capillaries, or excreted in urine. During this, the osmolarity at the inner medulla falls to 600. That's it for urea recycling. For watching the video until the end, I have a bonus point for you. Do you remember the types of nephrons? They are of two types: cortical nephrons and juxtamedullary nephrons. The cortical nephrons are located more superficially. Loops from only the juxtamedullary nephrons come very deep into the inner medulla. So the secretion of urea in the thin segment occurs mainly in the juxtamedullary nephrons only. Secretion in cortical nephrons is not significant. That's it for this video. If you liked it, please share it with your friends and colleagues too. And don't forget to subscribe, because lots more to come. Thanks for watching, see you in the next video.